Thank you, band and songsters, for introducing us to our worship on this Good Friday evening. This morning, we looked at Good Friday from the Gospel of John, that perspective. There are four Gospels, each of them present to us, tell us the story of Easter and, in particular, Good Friday, the day on which Jesus died. So we looked at John this morning. This evening, we're going to look at Matthew. Matthew's telling is quite long, so we've split it up into four readings, and straight away we're going to hear the first part of that. Andy is going to bring this to us.
And the first reading is Matthew 27, and verses 15 to 26. Now it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Jesus Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he knew it was out of self-interest that he handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him a message saying, "Don't have anything to do with this innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They answered, "Crucify him." "But why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate, but they all shouted the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw he was getting nowhere, but instead an uproar was starting, he took water, washed his hands in front of the crowd, and said, "I am innocent of this man's blood." He said, "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "His blood is on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified.
Thank you, Andy. And our, as ever, lovely cross display that Sue has put together for us reminds us, with the bowl and the towel, of Pilate washing his hands. And as I said this morning, it reminds me also of the night before, when Jesus took off his outer garment and washed the disciples' feet. Two different ways of washing there, with very different meanings. And of course, that was Pilate's way of absolving himself of guilt as far as he was concerned. Let's sing our first song together. There is a green hill far away without a city wall where the dear Lord was crucified, who died to save us all. Let's stand and sing, please.
Thank you.
The cross is not easy to understand, and yet it is right at the heart of Christianity. It is right at the heart of what Jesus did. There is more written in the Gospels about Jesus being crucified than anything else. And a good place to start to understand the cross, I think, is to look at the words of that song that we have just sung. Very, very simple words, but they pack in all the essentials that the Gospels declare, the essentials about what the cross means and what it does. They don't explain it, still difficult to explain, but they pack in all the essentials. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and a pure heart. That's what the psalmist asks, Psalm 24. You can see the words there on the screen. Are your hands clean? Were you ever asked that as a child before you sat down for dinner or before you went to school? Was it something that you got so used to hearing from mum and dad that your eyes would roll? For the psalmist, clean hands is a symbol about how we live our lives. The psalmist is saying, if you want to be with God, then your life must be clean. More precisely, the psalmist is probably saying, if you want to go up to the temple in Jerusalem, up on that hill they call Zion, that place where people go to meet with God, then your life must be clean. You shouldn't take it lightly, going to God's special, God's holy temple on the hill that they call Zion. Perhaps all of us here like to think we live mostly good lives. But what about our hands? One of the lessons we've learned over these pandemic years is that mostly clean hands isn't good enough. Of course, it was always true. Those who prepare food or perform surgery have known better than most that mostly clean hands isn't good enough. And if I want fellowship with God, the creator of the universe, if I want to climb his holy hill and bask in the glow of his glory, then I feel like being just mostly good is not enough. Psalm 24, verse 3 and 4, who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He, she, who has clean hands and a pure heart. And I think about what happened on that Thursday night of Easter at the Last Supper. It's recorded for us in chapter 13 of John's Gospel. Jesus washed the disciples' feet. And when he came to Peter, Peter at first said, "No, you shall never wash my feet." And Jesus said, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." You can't clean your own life just by doing lots of good things. Try that and you'll only be mostly clean. Do your very best and grubby bits will still show. Every single year we remind ourselves of this when we attempt New Year's resolutions. 2023 began just three and a half months ago. And if we tried to keep some New Year's resolutions, probably by now we've given up and we've failed. No matter how hard I try, there's still grubby bits. I just don't feel good enough to convene with the Almighty, God who is holy. There are all those stories about God in the Old Testament that emphasize his holiness in a way that sometimes we miss, we gloss over. We're so used to hearing that Jesus has reconciled us to God that we can approach him with boldness that we forget how amazing that is. And the Old Testament is full of stories about people not being able to look at God and live. And when Moses went up Mount Sinai, it was covered in cloud and fire when he received the Ten Commandments. God is a holy God. No matter how hard I try, there are still grubby bits. And so Peter says to Jesus, "Wash all of me." And Jesus, whose hands would soon be dirtied from carrying the rough wood of the cross, Jesus, whose hands would soon be stretched out and pierced by nails, Jesus says to Peter, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you. Don't obsess about the symbol. Let your life be washed, Jesus is saying to Peter. And Jesus is saying to us as well. Let your life be washed. And that is something that somehow Jesus achieves for us through his dying on the cross. And we're going to sing that chorus that is inspired by Psalm 51, "If on my soul a trace of sin remaineth," to that lovely tune, "Londonderry Air." And then after we've sung it, we'll spend some moments in prayer, please. Let's pray. As we sing, "Wash me, Lord, cleanse me," we remember the words of Psalm 51 attributed to David, King David, full of remorse after he had sinned, he'd committed adultery, he'd murdered. cleanse me with hyssop, he says. And this morning, Lord, we heard in John's Gospel how the wine vinegar was brought to the lips of Jesus on the end of some hyssop, and how the Israelites sprinkled the blood of the lambs over their doorposts, and they used hyssop to do it. And so we recognize, Father, that in Jesus' death, we have the same kind of cleansing. And we thank you for that, Father. We thank you that we can't do it in our own strength. We can't be clean in our own strength. Pilate washed his hands in front of the people, but it was an empty gesture. But because of you, we can be clean. We pray, Lord, that you will help us to experience the power of that cleansing. Not only today, Lord, but every day. And that through our lives, other people might see you and turn to you and love you. And as usual, Lord, we pray for our world. We pray for the hearts of leaders, that they will be cleansed by you. And that peace will reign. And that your kingdom will come. And so together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Mark is going to read for us the second part of the story as Matthew gives it to us.
The second reading is taken from Matthew chapter 20. Matthew chapter 27, verse 27 to 31. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand, and then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they'd mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him.
We sing again. We will stand, please, to sing. Jesus Christ, I think about your sacrifice.
Thank you.
Will is going to bring us the third instalment.
The third reading is from Matthew chapter 27 and verses 32 to 44. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall, but after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots, and sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him.
Thank you, Will. We'll listen to the songsters now, please. Thank you, songsters. Now Yian is going to read for us.
The fourth reading is from Matthew 27, verses 45 to 60. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and ordered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At the moment the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, the earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Many women were there, watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea, named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away.
Now we'll hear from the band, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, band. We started this meeting by thinking about washing hands. We recognised the lesson repeated many times recently that mostly clean isn't good enough. We recognise that belonging to God requires us to have lives which are really clean. Peter had to learn that in order to have a really clean life, a life that was clean enough to ascend God's hill, to be with God, he had to let Jesus do the washing for him. Even though Easter, bank holidays especially, is traditionally a time for DIY, you can't do it yourself. And the message of the gospel is that Jesus achieves this for Peter and the other disciples, even for us here today, by his death on the cross. That's how he achieves cleanliness of lives for you and me. It sounds foolish. The Apostle Paul wrote about how it seemed foolish to the people of his day. He wrote to the Corinthians, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." And yet somehow the cleansing nature of Christ's death resonates with human experience. Today we can identify with the pain of Good Friday when we look at the sacrifices that parents make for their children, or soldiers make for their country, or full-time carers for their sick relatives. Somehow it is true that there is life in dying. Not the reckless dying of terrorists who are determined to slaughter as many others as possible, but another kind of dying, a dying to self, which lifts others up, self-denial. And centuries before Jesus came along, the same idea appeared in Isaiah. And it seems that Jesus knew this passage back to front. There are little snippets of Isaiah chapter 53 in many of the things that Jesus says in the Gospels. I mentioned it this morning. Isaiah 53 verse 5 says, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed." Even our everyday language bears witness to the significance of Christ's death, with words like crucial, which means literally cross-like, and phrases like the crux of the matter. Crux, just a Latin word for cross. David wrote in Psalm 51, I mentioned it when I was praying, David wrote in Psalm 51 to God, "Cleanse me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow." You can't clean your own life just by doing lots of good things. Try that and you'll only be mostly clean. "Wash all of me then," said Peter to Jesus. "No way, Peter. This isn't really about baths. Don't get carried away with the symbol." I spotted a deep irony in these Good Friday events, which I want to share now. I've kind of referred to it already. Did you notice that what Pilate did when he couldn't persuade the crowd to have Jesus released? Matthew 27, verses 24 and 25, we heard it earlier. When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." And all the people answered, "Let his blood be on us and on our children." Pilate washed his hands symbolically. He didn't want to be held responsible for the death of Jesus. He didn't want the blood of Jesus on his hands. And yet the message of the gospel is that it is because of the blood of Jesus that every one of us can be clean, clean enough to be with God, to ascend God's hill. And paradoxically, the top of God's hill, the place where we can most fully know the glory of God, that place has a cross on it. And so in John's Gospel, Jesus talks about the time when the Son of Man will be glorified, and that is the time when Jesus is crucified. That's what he's referring to. The cross of Jesus Christ makes all the difference to a fallen world, a world that without it has only ever managed to be mostly clean. But with it, we can be pure, we can be spotless, we can be fit to be with God. And God loves the world so much that he gives Jesus, as the songster sang right at the beginning, God so loved the world. And Jesus loves the world so much that he gives himself. And that is why this Friday is called Good Friday. And so to conclude our worship this evening, we're going to sing a song, a petition to Jesus. Jesus, keep me near the cross. Because Jesus doesn't just die for us and expect us to look. He invites us. He invited the disciples to participate somehow in the sacrifice he made. The most visible way he did that at the Last Supper was by breaking the bread and sharing the wine and saying, this is my body, this is my blood, and inviting the disciples to eat of it. And Paul wrote to the Philippians, all I want to know is Christ and his suffering. And so somehow to be like him in death and to share in the resurrection. So Jesus doesn't only die for us, he invites us to participate in what he does, to take up our crosses and follow him. So here we are asking him to help us to do that. Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever. Let's stand, please, and sing all the words through. and a benediction. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all the benefits you have won for us, for all the pains and insults which you have borne for us. Most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen.